ICC statute, and then by scholars writing about the ICC in commentaries edited by Carses and Triftera, to refer to the entirety of norms governing the relationship between the ICC and national jurisdictions. 2. Complementarity in the International Criminal Court Statute, Art. 17. 12. The substantive rules that constitute the principle of complementarity are contained in Art. 17 ICC Statute. This article addresses issues of admissibility, so the question of complementarity therefore pertains to the admissibility of a case rather than the jurisdiction of the ICC, International Criminal Courts and Tribunals, procedure. Therefore, the principle of complementarity does not affect the existence of jurisdiction of the ICC as such, but regulates when this jurisdiction may be exercised by the ICC. The rules of procedure and evidence recognize this distinction by providing that the ICC shall rule on any challenge to its jurisdiction first before dealing with matters of admissibility. 13. According to Art. 17 ICC Statute, the ICC shall determine that a case is inadmissible on the basis of four factors. The core of this admissibility test is whether there is a national forum which has the willingness and ability to investigate and prosecute genuinely. The first two factors concern a situation where a state with jurisdiction, either a state party or a non-state party, is investigating or prosecuting the case at hand or has conducted an investigation and decided not to prosecute the person. In these circumstances, a case is only admissible if the state is shown to be unwilling or unable genuinely to carry out the investigation or prosecution, Art. 17 ICC Statute. 14. Three alternative criteria for unwillingness are provided in Art. 17. The ICC shall consider whether the national proceedings were for the purpose of shielding the person from criminal responsibility, there was an unjustified delay in the proceedings which was inconsistent with an intent to bring the person to justice, or the proceedings were not conducted independently or impartially and were not conducted in a manner consistent with bringing the person to justice. 15. For the determination of inability, in a particular case, the ICC shall consider whether, due to the total or substantial collapse or unavailability of its national judicial system, the state is unable to obtain the accused of the necessary evidence and testimony or otherwise unable to carry out proceedings, Art. 17. 3. Art. 17. 3. ICC Statute. 17. 3. ICC Statute. This could cover situations where there is a failed state, failing states, a civil war, armed conflict, non-international, or a natural disaster, see also state of emergency. 16. The third factor under Art. 17 concerns the situation where a person has already been tried for conduct which is the subject of the complaint in a trial by the ICC is not permitted under the principle of ne bis in idem. The final factor is where the case is not of sufficient gravity to justify further action by the ICC. This relates to the ICC's objective of prosecuting the most serious crimes of concern to the international community as a whole, preamble ICC statute. 3. Procedures under complementarity. 17. The procedural framework for complementarity allows states and the ICC to interact so that admissibility questions can be considered and resolved from a very early stage. The ICC is arbiter over the complementarity regime and may raise the issue proprio motu. As for the office of the prosecutor, complementarity is an issue that must be addressed from the start. 18. Where the office of the prosecutor wishes to initiate a proprio motu investigation, it is first obliged to consider whether the case would be admissible and to obtain authorization from a pre-trial chamber, international courts and tribunals, chambers. This ensures that the prosecution is not starting an investigation where national authorities are already acting. Where there is a state referral of a situation, the office of the prosecutor has a duty to notify states which would normally exercise jurisdiction over the crimes concerned of the referral. Within 1 month of receipt of the notification, states may inform the ICC that they have investigated or are investigating the crime. Dialogue between the state and the office of the prosecutor is encouraged and the office of the prosecutor may request additional information. In order to proceed, the office of the prosecutor must be authorized by a pre-trial chamber. If the ICC's investigation is deferred, the office of the prosecutor can request periodic information on the status of the national proceedings. It has been argued that the complementarity regime does not apply to Security Council referrals, but the majority of scholars contend that it does and the office of the prosecutor has proceeded with its investigation in the situation concerning Darfur, Sudan, on this basis. 19 challenges based on complementarity can be raised by the ICC, the Office of the Prosecutor, the accused, a state with jurisdiction, or a state from which acceptance of jurisdiction is required. 20 By September 2007, the principle of complementarity had been relevant in three situations that the Office of the Prosecutor has been investigating: Uganda, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, DRC, Congo, Democratic Republic of the, and Darfur. 21 Uganda made the first referral of situation to the ICC in December 2003. In July 2004, the Office of the Prosecutor decided to open an investigation. The referral raised the question of whether a state with a judicial system that is both willing and able to conduct a prosecution can voluntarily relinquish jurisdiction in favor of the ICC. Uganda did not claim that there has been a total or substantial collapse of its justice system or that its justice system was unavailable. There is also no indication that Uganda was unwilling to investigate and prosecute in the sense that national proceedings were delayed for the purposes of shielding the accused. The ICC prosecutor has spoken of a positive approach to complementarity whereby the ICC and the state agreed to a consensual division of labor, with the ICC prosecuting the leaders and the state prosecuting lower-ranking perpetrators. In May 2005, the prosecutor filed an application for warrants of arrest for crimes against humanity and war crimes against five senior commanders of the Lord's Resistance Army, which were issued by the pre-trial chamber. No arrests had been made as of September 2007. 22 The DRC referred the situation to the ICC in April 2004 and the Office of the Prosecutor decided to open an investigation 2 months later. In terms of the overall situation, the criteria of Art. 17.3 ICC statute concerning the genuine inability of the state to carry out the investigation a prosecution appeared to be met. However, this assessment had to be adjusted with the arrest of Mr. Thomas Lubanga Diallo. Mr. Lubanga had been arrested by Congolese authorities in February 2006 following the killing of 9 UN peacekeepers in Ituri. He was transferred to the ICC in March 2006 pursuant to an arrest warrant for the war crimes of enlisting, conscripting and using children under the age of 15 to participate actively in hostilities, children and armed conflict. In its decision on the warrant application, the ICC pre-trial chamber stated that it is a conditio sine qua non for a case arising from an investigation of a situation to be inadmissible that national proceedings encompass both the person and the conduct which is the subject of the case before the court. The prosecutor v. Thomas Lubanga Diallo, warrant of arrest, the 10th of February 2006, ICC 01-04-01-06 less than library slash cases slash ic-01-04-01-06 6-2_tengelish.pdf the 15th of December 2007. Since the conduct for which Mr. Lubanga was being held in the DRC was different to the war crimes he was accused of by the ICC Office of the Prosecutor, his case was considered admissible. 23 In March 2005, the Security Council adopted UNSC Resolution 1593 referring the situation in Darfur, the Sudan, to the ICC. In March 2005, the Security Council adopted UNSC Resolution 1593 referring the situation in Darfur, the Sudan, to the ICC. In accordance with the ICC statute, the Office of the Prosecutor conducted a preliminary examination of the situation. On this basis, the prosecutor opened the investigation in June 2005. At the same time, Sudan established the Special Criminal Court for events in Darfur. It has in place a Judicial Investigation Committee and Special Prosecutions Commissions. In February 2007, the prosecutor made an application to the pre-trial chamber to issue summonses to appear against two named individuals. The application did not allege that the Sudanese government was unable to investigate or prosecute those individuals. Rather, the prosecutor stated that the Sudanese authorities had not investigated or prosecuted the case which was the subject of the application. On this basis, the prosecutor concluded that the case was admissible. As of September 2007, the two individuals had not appeared before the ICC. 4. Impact of the ICC on universal criminal jurisdiction exercised by states. 24. The complementarity regime of the ICC is designed to encourage full and genuine domestic prosecutions of crimes. This would be a positive development as national courts are often best placed to deal with core international crimes. by acknowledging that the effective prosecution of core international crimes depends on action by national authorities. The principle of complementarity contained in the ICC statute may act as a catalyst encouraging states to investigate and prosecute serious violations of human rights. This will contribute to the fundamental objectives of international criminal law, namely, the avoidance of impunity and the deterrence of future crimes. The challenges. 25. The establishment of the ICTY, ICTR and the mixed internationalized criminal jurisdictions, the exercise of universal jurisdiction by national courts, and the creation of a permanent international criminal court signal the emergence of a system of international criminal justice. There has been an evolution from ad hoc attempts to enforce international law in specific situations to a developing, interdependent system aiming to end impunity for serious violations of international criminal law around the world. The ICC forms only a small part of this system. There are temporal, substantive, and resource limits on what it can do. The principle of complementarity gives the court a supplementary role, not a primary one, in investigating and prosecuting core international crimes. 26. The change from primary jurisdiction to complementary jurisdiction alters the balance between state sovereignty and international criminal justice. The ICC's principle of complementarity affirms the obligation of states to prosecute core international crimes. It implies that there will often be a division of labor between the ICC and national courts. The ICC will prosecute some of those who bear the greatest responsibility for crimes while the national authorities bring other perpetrators to justice. The national authorities may not always be in a position to do this. An impunity gap will open up between the few cases which the ICC will be able to investigate and prosecute, and the numerous cases which the national authorities are unable to deal with. The involvement of the court will highlight this gap. This is likely to create challenges beyond expectation management. 27. But if the ICC prosecutes those most responsible, reinvigorated national authorities might then be able to deal with other cases. If not, the international community will have a continuing role in encouraging national and international efforts to ensure that perpetrators of serious core international crimes are brought to justice. It is clear that the principle of complementarity requires the ICC to be embedded in a broader system. Its jurisdictional regime needs the multiple engagement of states to be effective. Select bibliography. A. Zimmerman, The Creation of a Permanent International Criminal Court, 1998, 2 Max Planck INIB 169-237. L. Arbour and M. Bergsmo, Conspicuous Absence of Jurisdictional Overreach, in Ham von Hebel, J. G. Lammers and J. Schuking, Eds, Reflections on the International Criminal Court, Essays in Honor of Adrian Boss, TMC Assa Press, The Hague, 1999, 129-40. B. Broomhall, The International Criminal Court, A Checklist for National Implementation, in International Association of Penal Law, ed. ICC Ratification and National Implementing Legislation, Eris Toulouse, 1999, 113-59. C. K. Hall, Challenges to the Jurisdiction of the Court of the Admissibility of a Case, in O. Triftera, ed. Commentary on the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court, Observer's Notes, article by article, Nomos Baden-Baden, 1999, 405-18. J. T. Holmes, The Principle of Complementarity, in R. S. Lee, ed. The International Criminal Court, The Making of the Rome Statute, Issues, Negotiations, Results, Clue with the Hague, 1999, 41-78. S. Williams, Issues of Admissibility, in O. Triftera, ed. Commentary on the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court, Observer's Notes, article by article, Nomos Baden-Baden, 1999, 383-94. J. T. Holmes, Jurisdiction and Admissibility, in R. S. Lee, ed. International Criminal Court, Elements of Crimes and Rules of Procedure and Evidence, Transnational Publishers, Ardsley, New York, 2001, 321-48. J. T. Holmes, Complementarity, National Courts versus the ICC, in A. Carses, P. Gator and J. R. W. D. Jones, eds. The Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court, A Commentary, OUP Oxford 2002, 667-86. M. M. L. Zaidi, The Principle of Complementarity, A New Machinery to Implement International Criminal Law, 2001-02, 23 Mike Ginnell 869-975. MSLS, the International Criminal Court and its implication for domestic law and national capacity building, 2002-03, 15 flagellal 215-42. M. Benzing, the complementarity regime of the International Criminal Court, International Criminal Justice between State Sovereignty and the Fight Against Impunity, 2003, 7 Max Blankinib 591-632. J. K. Kleffner, the impact of complementarity on national implementation of substantive international criminal law, 2003, 1, JICJ, 86113. H. Olasolo, the prosecutor of the ICC before the initiation of investigations, a quasi-judicial or a political body. 2003, 3 INTLCLR 87-150. R. Wolfram, prosecution of international crimes by international and national criminal courts, concurring jurisdiction, in Study di diritto internazionale in honor di Gaetano Arangio Ruiz, Editorial Scientifica Napoli 2000.